biology.
Yes, hello there and welcome again to this class. We are today, I want us to discuss about food tests. So we have different food tests, and today we are going to begin with testing of vitamin C, starch, reducing sugar, and reducing sugar, and lipid test among protein. So let's begin with the first one, which is the simplest, which is testing for vitamin C. So how will you test for vitamin C? So you take the food sample, you put in into the test tube, and then you add a few drops of DCP. So if vitamin C is present, the purple color of DCPAP will change from purple to colorless. That is vitamin C. Now let's look at the next one, which is testing for starch. So how do you test for starch? So first of all, you will take the food sample and place it inside the test tube again, maybe 1 cm³ of the food sample of it, or if it's solid, you place it there. Then after that, you add a few drops of iodine solution. So the few drops of iodine solution will be brown in color. So if starch is present, now the brown color of the iodine solution will change from brown to blue, black, which will indicate that iodine is present. Now let's look at the next one, which is now testing for reducing sugar. So how will you test for the reducing sugar? So you'll take the food sample and place the food sample inside the test tube, and then you will add like 2 cm³ of Benedict solution, which is blue in color. So after adding 2 cm³ of the blue Benedict solution, I will take that test tube and place it in a warm water bath. Why should we place it in a warm water bath? So as to accelerate the process of, or to accelerate the chemical reaction that will take place. Now, if reducing sugar is present in the food sample color, or rather the color of the Benedict solution, will change from blue color to either green, orange, red, or brown to indicate that there's a maximum that is brown, or to indicate there's very little that is green. Now let's look at the next food test, which is non-reducing sugar. So how do you test for the non-reducing sugar? So as the reducing sugar, will take the food sample and place it in the test tube. Then after doing that, we'll add 1 or 2 cm³ of hydrochloric acid. So why should we add hydrochloric acid? We'll add hydrochloric acid so as to break down the monosaccharides inside the disaccharide in the non-reducing sugar. So after adding a few drops of hydrochloric acid, we'll take the test tube and place it again inside a warm water bath to accelerate the chemical reaction. So after placing it into the warm water bath, then what is the next step? We are going to extract the test tube from the warm water bath and then add some few drops or 2 cm³ of sodium hydrogen carbonate. So when adding sodium hydrogen carbonate, you'll notice that effervescence and fizzing will occur. So what's the reason for effervescence and fizzing? So the reason for this is that carbon dioxide is the one which is escaping from the reaction. So in the reaction, we are going to get sodium carbonate, water, and carbon dioxide. So when carbon dioxide is escaping, that's when we get the fizzing. So after fizzing has stopped, we are going to add like 2 cm³ of Benedict solution. So like after adding the 2 cm³ of Benedict solution, we'll take the test tube and place it again inside the warm water bath to accelerate the chemical reaction. So if non-reducing sugar is present, rather, the color of the Benedict solution will change from blue to either green, orange, red, or brown to indicate there's a high amount of non-reducing sugar, or green to indicate there is a very low amount of reducing sugar. So the next test we are going to look at is lipid emulsion test, where we are going to test for lipids. So what happens in the emulsion test? So you take a food sample, let's say for example milk, place it in the test tube, that is 2 cm³. Then after that, you take again like 2 cm³ or 3 cm³ of ethanol, and then we place it again, or we mix it inside the test tube that was containing milk. So after doing that, we'll take the test tube and shake it vigorously. So after shaking vigorously, what's the next step? We are going to take another test tube that has distilled water, and then this test tube which has the mixture, and then slowly pour the mixture inside the test tube that has clean water. So if lipid is present, then a suspension, a white milky suspension will be formed inside the test tube that we are pouring in the contents. But if lipid is not present, the liquid most likely will remain clear. So there's another test for lipid which is called the grease spot test, whereby we take the food sample, a very small food sample, maybe from the top of the dropper with a filter paper, and then we place it like that. So if lipid is present, a translucent patch will be formed on the filter paper. Then lastly, let's look at the protein test. So how do you test for proteins? So we have two tests here, and we are going to begin with the first one, which is called the burette test. So in the burette test, we are going to take the food sample, we place it inside the test tube. So after doing that, we are going to take sodium hydroxide and also add about equal amounts of sodium hydroxide into the test tube. So after adding amounts of sodium hydroxide, the last step we're going to do, we are going to add like 2 cm³ to the test tube. So you can put it in a warm water bath, or you can wait for it to change manually, but you can use the water bath to accelerate the process. So if protein is present, the blue color of the copper 2 sulfate solution will change from blue to purple color, indicating the presence of protein. So if protein is not present, the blue color of the Benedict solution, of the copper 2 sulfate solution rather, will persist. So what's the last step, the last experiment of protein? So the last experiment of protein is called, it doesn't have a name, but we are using the litmus paper to test for protein. So how are we going to use the litmus paper to test for protein? So first of all, we're going to take the food sample, we place it in the test tube. Then after doing that, you are going to add 2 to 1 cm³ of copper 2 oxide solution, or if you are using a solid copper 2 oxide, you are going to add some drops of water to make it damp or to make it moist, so that you add into the food sample that's in the test tube. So after that, dampen the red litmus paper and the blue litmus paper, and then take the litmus papers and place them on top of the test tube that has the contents. So after that, heat. You take the test tube and you place it in a warm water bath, then you record your observations. So if protein is present in the sample, the color of the red litmus paper will change from red to blue color, indicating the presence of protein. Again, if you smell the contents, you will smell the smell of ammonia, ammonia gas. So the ammonia gas is responsible for turning the red litmus paper to color blue. So all these tests were food tests, and mostly they mostly come in essays, and you should be very careful to know all of them. So this has been today's class. Let's meet on the next class as we proceed more on biology.